What would it look like if you chose to follow Jesus? What if? That's a great question. It's one of my favorite questions, actually, of all time. And there's actually a show out there from Marvel. I don't know if any of you are Marvel fans. What If was a show that Marvel launched. It's a cartoon, but it explored different avenues or different prospects of things to happen. Like, so for example, what if Peggy Carter took the Super Soldier Serum instead of Steve Rogers? Or what if Doctor Strange lost his love of his life as opposed to the hand that he loved to work with so much? You see, that this idea of exploring different alternate realities. And the thing is, back to our original question, what if you chose to follow Jesus? What would be the implications for that? What might have to change? See, odds are you've actually already considered what if you chose to follow Jesus. Maybe you've already given an affirmative decision on that behalf. Like, you're like, yeah, I do follow Jesus. Or maybe you've chosen, I don't want to because I know there's a cost associated with following him that I'm unwilling to give up. See, as we explore what it looks like to follow Jesus, or as we ask that question, I think it's important to just continue to have a posture of humility and a posture of curiosity. And so what I want to challenge you with in this next little video is just for a few minutes, open up the idea, open up the prospect of what if. Now, if you've chosen to already give your life to Jesus, still hang with me, because here's why. I think sometimes what we associate following Jesus with, going to church and Sunday school and the normal things of faith, it actually might look slightly different than we actually think that, or than it actually kind of is. And so open this door, all right, in your life, and just open your brain for it. Because actually, there's actually a psychological, a learning method that relates to all of this. Okay, so I want to share that with you. There's going to be some slides up here on the screen to help illustrate it. But let's just put like these five arrows on the screen. We're going to call this the cycle of learning, okay? And then this first spot right here, we're going to put input. Or another word might be like data, all right? A thing, some sort of knowledge, okay? Now pretend for a minute, let's go down a hypothetical scenario. Let's pretend that you want to become a YouTuber. So what would it take to become a YouTuber? Well, first of all, you would have to learn how to video edit, okay? So that's the input here. This skill, this piece of content about how to edit video. All right, well, what happens next? Well, next, you have to determine whether or not there's value associated with this data or with this input. So if you want to become a YouTuber, then there is automatically value associated with this input here, right? Because you want to do this, and so it's going to be a necessary thing for you to do it. Now let's flip the script. Let's pretend instead of a YouTuber, it's calculus. Maybe you're like, I don't ever want to do math again for my entire life post high school. Listen, I get it. Math is the worst, okay? So you get this input or this data from your teacher, here's how to do calculus, but you haven't assigned it any value because you're like, I think it's worthless, pointless, and stupid. Great, I get it, and maybe even agree with you a little bit, okay? Now back to the YouTube conversation. Then there's this speculation. What would happen if I applied this piece of information? Now, in this case, if you're starting a YouTube channel, what would happen? Well, maybe you become famous. Maybe a lot of people would know your name. Maybe you would get a lot of money based off of ads. Or maybe you put in all this work and nothing happens and you only end up with 7 subscribers. I'm speaking hypothetically, of course, and not out of personal experience. Totally out of personal experience. Okay, so you go through all this work and you get to this spot of speculation. That's what we're talking about, right? This what if. What if? And here's the thing. Most of us do this subconsciously. We weigh the pros and the cons of what might happen. Now here's the thing though. There's a broken piece in our arrow, in our diagram here. And right here, this is the broken piece. It's called the knowledge and action gap, because everything beforehand is just knowledge. Here's the thing, we've decided if there's value in that thing or not, and then what would happen if we did it. But then this gap right here, it's called the knowledge and action gap. we experience the knowledge and action gap on a daily basis. For example, you know that it's more beneficial for you to eat broccoli than it is for you to eat Skittles, right? You know that, but maybe your actions don't follow that. Or you know it's going to be beneficial for you to work out. You know that, but you stay in bed because your bed is so much warmer than getting up and exercising. See what I'm saying? We exercise this every single day. So same thing. And this is why it's important. Even if you would say and declare, I have a personal relationship with Jesus, you know this stuff. However, are you living it out? And are the repercussions or the results of following Jesus worth you actually taking that knowledge and putting it into action, crossing the knowledge and action gap? Again, you do this every day. You weigh out all these scenarios. You do this subconsciously, right? But I'm just putting words to it so that you can understand what it takes. So that's where we are, right? I just want to stop right here on the speculation. Now, if you continue to go on, you would enter into the trying phase, and then you'd enter into the doing phase. And so you would, you know, launch a YouTube channel, you do the thing, you try a few sample videos first, and then you launch it officially, right? That's the completion of this learning method here, right? But here's the question. Back to the speculation. Right before the knowledge and action gap, I want to take you right to the shores of speculation, and it's this. What if you chose to follow Jesus? You know, in our church, we actually call this the explore phase. And Jesus actually modeled it for us. I want to take you to a passage here. It's in the book of John, chapter 1, verse 25. And here's what happens. It says, the following day, John, this is talking about John the Baptist. So if you've grown up in church at all, you've probably heard this before. But John was standing with two of his disciples. And so as Jesus walked by, John looked at him and declared about Jesus, right? He said, look, it is the Lamb of God. And so when John's two disciples heard this, they followed Jesus, right? They got to the shores of speculation. They started asking this what if, and they said, what if who John says is the Lamb of God, what if he's the Messiah, the long-awaited Messiah? Verse 38, Jesus looked around, he saw them, he said, what do you want? What a welcoming phrase, am I right? So he said, what do you want? And they said, teacher, rabbi, where are you staying? Jesus said, come and see. So it was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon when this happened. They went with him to the place where he was staying, and they remained with him the rest of the day. Andrew, who's Simon Peter's brother, was one of these men who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. So there's two men, right? One's Andrew. Scholars believe the other one to be John. We're not totally sure. It doesn't say it here, but Andrew heard what John the Baptist had said and went and followed Jesus. Then, after the meeting, Andrew went to find his brother Simon, and he says, we have found the Messiah. Andrew brought Simon to meet Jesus, and then looking intently at Simon, Jesus said, your name is not Simon, son of John, but you will now be called Cephas, which is an Aramaic word we know and translate to Peter. Okay, there's a lot going on here, but what I want you to notice is that Jesus invited these two guys to come and see. Now, here's why this is significant. If you grew up in a Jewish culture, you're going to know this. But if not, let me give you a quick history. Every young Jewish boy goes to school, goes to religious school. And the school that they go to is a place called Bet Sefer, which means the house of the book. All right, so think of this as like primary school for Jewish boys and girls. So they go and they often memorize the Pentateuch or the first five books, the Torah of the Bible. They have it memorized, okay? By the time that kind of ends, and what they do is they take like the cream of the crop or the best of the best out of that school, and they move them on to another school called Bet Talmud, which is the house of learning. If you weren't good enough to continue on, you'd go back home and you'd continue on in your family business. Then you go through the house of learning, Bet Talmud, and after that, eventually, again, the cream of the crop would be raised up, and a rabbi would look at them and they would promote them on to what we would say like a seminary level degree, going to Bet Midrash, which is the house of study. If you didn't make it there, again, you went back to the family business and working on the trade, okay? Continuing on, you went all the way through that school, and if you made it all the way through that school, if you were elite enough, if you were cream of the crop enough, you would have a rabbi look at you, and the rabbi would answer this question inherently, right? Are you good enough? And the rabbi would answer, if you're good enough, by saying, yes, come and follow me. And you'd go and you'd follow that rabbi. You'd learn the teachings of that rabbi, the customs of that rabbi. And so we know that in this situation, right, Andrew and this other guy, right, presumably John, were followers, disciples of John the Baptist. But Peter, or Simon, as we learned at the beginning of the story, was not. Here's why we know that. If you cross-reference this with Matthew chapter 4, verse 18, Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee. He saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting nets into the lake, for they were fishermen. So we know that at one level that Peter had learned the answer to this question of, am I good enough to be a disciple? Am I good enough to follow one of these rabbis? The answer is no. Why? Because we saw him. He was a fisherman. Right? He'd given up on school, or maybe not even given up, but been told, you're done, and I need you to go back to the family business. And so that's what Peter was doing. I don't know if you've ever been told you're not good enough, but it's a really painful experience. You know, for myself, I grew up loving the sport of basketball. Still do, my favorite sport. And in sixth grade, I decided I'm going to go try out for the team. I wasn't any good. I just shot on my driveway with my rim that had a lot of give and bounce to it. And so my shots went in a lot. And so I went, tried out, and I got cut. I didn't really care. I didn't think much of it. And I didn't really anticipate making the team too much. Tried out in seventh grade again. Got cut. Moved to a new school. Tried out in eighth grade. Got cut. At this point, it was starting to get a little painful. And so instead of just shooting on my driveway, I asked my parents if I could join a league. And so I did. I joined a league. And I played all the time. And I got better, got better, got better. So I finally went out and went out for ninth grade. Got cut. So next year, instead of just playing in a rec league, I played every moment. I signed up for every seasonal sport. I played that winter when all the other guys were playing school basketball. I played in a league that I found. Then I went and I signed up for a higher level, higher competition league. And I played and I played and I played and I played and I got coaching and coaching and did all the things. And you know what I did? I finally went to tryouts the next year. My sophomore year, I went. And they're going through tryouts, the whole thing. I know the experience, right? Because I've been cut every year. But this time, this year, I sat down with the coach. He said, hey, come into my office for a minute. Oh, hey. This is new, right? I go in, he's like, this is really hard. He said, here's why it's hard. He said, because you have improved a lot from last year. That's amazing. He said, but you're the 13th guy in my list on a 12-man roster. The last cut. What I can do is I can offer you a spot as a manager. You can come, you can practice with us, you can deliver balls and water and warm-ups. But can't be on the team. If you are with us for a year, learn our system, learn our plays, you might be good enough to make the team next year. It's really hard to be told that you're not good enough. Right? Thankfully for Simon, his brother Andrew remained curious. He was on the shores of speculation, wondering, what if this is the Messiah? Because here's what happens. I want to point something out to you. In John 1:42 is the last verse that we read. Right? It says this. It says, then Andrew brought Simon to meet Jesus. And looking intently at Simon, Jesus said, your name is Simon, son of John, but you will be called Cephas, which means Peter. Now, I don't know about you, right? But if this happened to me, I'd be like, dude, who are you? Like, my brother just came and told you I need to come meet you, but now you're just changing my name? Like, I'd be a little weirded out. But there's something powerful about a name change in the Bible. Right, like think about it, like Abram turned to Abraham, which was significant because it means the father of many nations. Jacob turned to Israel, which means he who wrestles with God, and ultimately Israel became the main name referred to of the Jewish people. And Saul, who was persecuting Christians, became Paul, to be known as one of the greatest apostles ever to walk this earth, and he wrote over half of our New Testament. A name change matters, and Jesus gave Peter a name change. He went from Simon, which actually, believe it or not, is one of the most common names in first century Judaism. Almost everyone around was named Simon. It was a very common name. People heard it all the time. And he took this common name, and he said, you're not Simon anymore. I got plans for you. You are Peter. So why does this matter? Why do all these things matter? Because here's why. What if you chose to follow Jesus? And not just the Jesus that you think, and not just the Jesus that we see hanging up in our grandmother's house, and not just the Jesus that we see on the rosary, but what if you chose to follow Jesus, the one who calls people by name? Because not only did he do this with Simon, but he wants to do it with you. Right? Like, actually, it says it in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, Paul writes about it. He says, if anyone is a new creation, the old ways of living are gone and the new has come. So what if? What if even as you heard this, you're like, yeah, I still don't know. I get it. But as we enter into this idea of what it means to follow Jesus and how to take steps towards him, one of the necessary phases in that is what we call the explore phase. Andrew was willing to do it. He was willing to explore the claims of Jesus. Is this guy really the Messiah? Peter was willing to let this guy change his ultimate identity, and that changed Peter, who was a fisherman, who was told he was not good enough, and it changed the trajectory of his life from that fateful meeting, that fateful moment. My question is, can that same Jesus do the same for you?